It's true, I can never earn your grace. Still, you give it freely every day. Even when my mind is overcome, say I won't be left here on my own. Your love is not distracted by my shame. You're near to me, you understand my pain. And when my burdens bring me to my knees, you are always there to carry me. I failed under pressure despite all my efforts, but your love keeps no record.
An art gallery owner said to an artist, "I have some good news and some bad news." The artist replied, "What is the good news?" The gallery owner said, "The good news is that a man came in today asking if the price of your paintings would go up after you die. When I told him they would, he bought every one of your paintings." "Artist, that's great. What's the bad news?" The gallery owner, "He's your doctor." "Doctor, do you want the good news first or the bad news?" "Man, good news first, please, doc. Doctor, we're naming a disease after you." You coming around, right? "Lawyer, I have some good news and some bad news." "Client, well, give me the bad news first." "Lawyer, the bad news is the DNA test showed that it was your blood they found all over the crime scene." "Client, oh no, I'm ruined. What's the good news?" "Lawyer, your cholesterol's down to 130. A man was deeply involved in finishing a report for his upcoming board meeting when he received a call from his wife saying that she had good news and bad news. Because of the deadline, he asked if she could just give him the good news. So his wife replied, "Okay, the good news is that the airbags in your car work." Last one. Two buddies, Bob and Earl, were two of the biggest baseball fans in America. Their entire adult lives, Bob and Earl discussed baseball history in the winter, and they pored over every box score during the season. They went to 60 games a year. They even agreed that whoever died first would try to come back and tell the other if there was baseball in heaven. One summer night, Bob passed away in his sleep after watching the Yankees' victory earlier in the evening. He died happy. A few nights later, his buddy Earl awoke to the sound of Bob's voice from beyond. "Bob, is that you?" Earl asked. "Of course it's me," Bob replied. "This is unbelievable," Earl exclaimed. "So tell me, is there baseball in heaven?" "Well, I have some good news and some bad news for you. Which do you want first?" "Tell me the good news first." "Well, the good news is that yes, there is baseball in heaven, Earl." "Oh, that's wonderful. So what could possibly be the bad news?" "Well, you're pitching tomorrow night." Just let that sink in. You know, we live in a time and a culture of good news, bad news situations. So if you had to receive good news and bad news together, which would you want first? So by a show of hands, how many of you say, "I would want the good news first"? Give me that first. Anybody? All right, couple of people. How many of you say, no, give me the bad news first? Okay, well, if you say bad news, you're actually going right along with what most people think. According to an article in Psychology Today, they did a poll where they asked people, if you're going to have good news and bad news given to you, what do you want first? 78% of the people said they want the bad news first. Because they said if they get the bad news, they can get past that, and then they hear good news. Emotionally, it builds them back up, and they end on a good note. So most of you are right in line with what our culture says. They would rather have the bad news first. What's interesting is, as we go into Ephesians chapter 2, Paul is going to give us a couple of different situations where he has to share good news and bad news. And fortunately for most of you, he's going to do what you want. He's going to start with the bad news first. But then he's going to follow it up with some really, really good news. So if you've got your Bibles, would you turn to Ephesians chapter 2? Ephesians chapter 2. We're going to split this chapter into two messages. So we'll cover some bad news, good news today, and then we will do the same thing next week as well. But Ephesians chapter 2, we're going to begin reading in verse 1. Paul says, "As for you, you were dead in your transgression and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the Spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. So Paul begins with some pretty bad news because he says to us, you're dead. Now, obviously, he's not talking about a physical death. He's talking about a spiritual death. But we are spiritually dead before we come into a relationship with God. And he says, you're dead because of your sins and your transgressions. Now, if you look at those words, you may think to yourself, well, they mean the same thing. Okay, sin, transgression, some people use the word iniquity. All of those mean the exact same thing, but they don't. In fact, if we do a little bit of a word study, you'll realize that these are two different things that Paul is talking about. If you look at the word sin, if you define that word the way they would have understood it in the first century, sin was simply missing the mark. And so you're trying to be righteous, you're trying to do good, you're trying to follow the law of God and be a good person, but you just missed the mark. It's like if you were shooting an arrow and you had a target and you're trying to hit the middle of that and hit the bullseye, but you don't. It goes right or left. It goes too high or too low. You simply miss the mark. You don't live up to the standard that God has set. And that happens to all of us. And so that's called sin. We sin sometimes trying to do what's right. But transgressions, on the other hand, it's totally different. The idea behind that word is rebellion, where God sets his standard and we just say, well, I don't care. I know what God says. I know what God thinks I ought to do, but I'm going to do what I want to do. And so we just rebel against God and we're not worried at all about the consequences that will come with that. And so Paul says to us, you are dead in your sin and your transgressions, sometimes just missing the mark, and sometimes you're rebelling and just saying, I want to do what I want to do. And he attributes that to the fact that we are following our flesh. We are doing what our flesh wants. As human beings, we actually inherit this thing called a sinful nature. Where leave us alone long enough, we're going to sin. We see that as children begin to grow up. You know, they do things when they're little, but it's not like, I'm just going to break God's law. I'm going to break my parents' law. They're just doing what you do. But then it gets to a point when they get older and they start going, I don't care what my mom and dad say. I'm going to do whatever I want to do. And that's when they become accountable. It's that sinful nature that we have inside of us. And it's just letting the flesh rule. And in fact, he also says what you're doing is you're following the ruler of the kingdom of the air, which is a reference to Satan. And when we give in to the flesh, when we ignore what God wants for our lives, then we are just following the path that Satan has for us. And so we are dead in who we are, in our spiritual relationship with God. That sin breaks that relationship because God is perfect and holy. He can't be around sin. That's the bad news. And that's kind of bad, right? I mean, you look at that and you go, oh man, he just said we're dead. And we're dead because we're sinning, we're transgressing, we're doing what we want to do, we're rebelling against God. And so that's a pretty bad situation for us to find ourselves in. The good thing is, he's going to follow up the bad news with good news. Will you go back to chapter 2 of Ephesians? Let's pick it up in verse 4. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming age that he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Now again, Paul is going to break this down a little bit, and he says, listen, the bad news is you're dead, but there's good news in that, because in God's great love, he showed you mercy and grace. God loved us, human beings, so much that he wanted to help us fix this sin problem and sin issue that we have. And the only thing I can compare that to is a parent-child relationship. Those of you that have kids, you know what I'm talking about, right? You're willing to give up your life for your child. I would do that for Marley and Maddie without ever thinking about it. Man, I would want them to live, and I would die in their place. And that's how much God loves us. His love is so great that He shows us mercy and He shows us grace. Now again, the whole idea of mercy and grace may sound like the exact same thing. We hear those words and we go, yeah, that means the same, right? But no, it really doesn't. See, mercy is God not giving us what we deserve. Okay, what do we deserve? We deserve to be punished. We have sinned, we deserve to be punished, we deserve to be separated from God for all eternity. That's what we deserve, but God's mercy says, I'm not going to give you what you deserve. Instead, I'm going to give you my grace. And grace is God giving us what we do not deserve. We did not deserve for Jesus to come and die in our place. We didn't deserve for Jesus to take our punishment like He had done wrong, and so He was crucified, nailed to a cross. We did not deserve to have those things done for us and given to us. But Paul says that's what God does because of great love. He shows us mercy and He shows us grace. And there is no more beautiful picture of what Jesus does for us when He moves us from death to life than in our baptism. So I like what he says. He said, but Jesus moves us. We were dead. He made us alive. That's why we called this series Death to Life. And you can see that transition when you think about a baptism. Let me show you exactly what I mean. Watch this video.
All right, Emily, I'm going to ask if you would repeat a good confession after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the Living God.
The Son of the Living God.
And I take Him as my Savior.
And I take Him as my Savior.
Awesome. And because of that confession of faith, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of all your sins. And you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
And mercy paid the price. My future came alive. Your love and grace divine.
Okay. Guys, I'm going to ask you to repeat the same confession. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the Living God.
The Son of the Living God.
And I take Him as my Savior. That is awesome to hear you say that. It's awesome that I'm getting to do this because we weren't sure of any of this, not too long ago. So this is amazing. Because of your confession of faith, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the Living God, you're now being baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of all your sins. You're going to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Colossians chapter 2 and verse 12 says it this way, having been buried with Him in baptism, in which you were also raised with Him through your faith in the working of God, who raised Him from the dead. Paul said it another way in Romans chapter 6. He said, or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into His death? We were therefore buried with Him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Couldn't you see that in that baptism? You think about Jesus who was alive and yet He went to the cross. He was nailed there for our sin, covered in our sin. He was buried, but then on the third day He was raised back to life. And that's what we see when somebody embraces the gift of grace through Jesus Christ, when they are baptized into Him. That old person covered in sin is buried. It's done away with. Those sins are washed away and then they come back again ready to live a new life full of the Holy Spirit. It is a beautiful picture of being brought from death into life. And that's what God did for us. His love was so great that He showed His mercy, did not give us what we deserved, but gave us His grace. He gave us what we did not deserve. But you know, there are some people who say, you know what? We have nothing to do with the process of our salvation. So you know what? We can't do anything to earn God's love and to earn God's forgiveness. And I absolutely agree with that wholeheartedly. There's nothing that you and I can do. We'll never be able to stand before God and say, God, I deserve Jesus to die for me. God, I have done all these things in my life. I have earned the right to come to heaven. We cannot do that. God does it through His mercy and His grace, through the sacrifice of Jesus. But that does not mean that we don't have a part in it. Because when we accept Jesus Christ, we are told in Scripture that we are to be immersed into Christ. It's not baptism that saves us. It is God's mercy through our faith. But we have to have a faith that works. We have to have a faith that does something. In fact, let me read to you from James. This is Jesus' little brother, and he wrote a letter to us as Christians, and he said it this way in chapter 2 and verse 17, in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Then he says in verse 24, you see that a person is considered righteous by what they do and not by faith alone. But I want you to understand this process of salvation. I want you to understand the idea of baptism, dying to our old self, being raised to life again. We do not earn that, but we are a part of that process. And let me see if I can show you what I mean. I have in my hand a $5 bill, and I'm going to give this $5 bill away to somebody who will come up here on stage with me. Would anybody like to have $5? Okay, come on. Whoever, it's first come, first serve. All right? Okay, so coffee money? That's terrible. All right, so I told you if somebody would come up on stage with me, I would give them $5, correct?
What's the bad news?
Okay, there is no bad news, dude. Here's your $5, but don't go anywhere. Stay here for just a minute, okay? Would you guys say that Tom earned that $5? Did he earn it? I'm asking you guys, did he earn that $5? What did he do to earn it? I just told him to come up here. Did he work? No. Did he have to exert effort? Not really. It's like 8-10 steps up here. Tom did not earn that $5, but what he did was he positioned himself in a place where he could receive that $5. Okay? You and I do not earn salvation. We don't earn grace. We don't earn mercy. But faith works. Our faith says, I've got to put something into action. And so we put ourselves in a place where we can receive God's mercy and grace. You can be seated and you can keep the $5. Don't buy coffee, though. It's bad for you. All right, so here's the idea. I don't want you to confuse. See, people say you're saved by faith. You're saved by grace through faith. And so nothing you do is a part of that. But it is. We are told that's what we do. Now, let me show you, though, because I want you to see why people think you have nothing to do in the process of salvation. Look back at chapter 2 of Ephesians. Let's pick it up in verse 8. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. See, if we could work our way into salvation, then we would all walk around prideful. We would all walk around and tell other people, you know what, if you was as good as me, you could be saved too. And Paul says, no, you're saved by grace through faith. This is not from yourselves. You're not working it, but you've got to put yourself in a position to be able to receive that grace. And you do that by putting your faith into action. And whatever God tells you to do in order to come in contact with the blood of Jesus, to die to your old self and live to a new self, then that's what you're willing to do. And we're told in Scripture, you believe, you repent, you confess, and you are baptized into Christ, where your sins are washed away and you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Listen, you are not saved by works, but you are saved to work. Okay, y'all see the difference? You're not saved by works. You're not ever going to work your way into the forgiveness God gives it for free. You're never going to work your way into heaven. But if you've accepted Jesus Christ, you know that faith is dead if you don't work. In other words, people ought to be able to see Jesus Christ living in us. They ought to be able to see that the Holy Spirit is working in us. And so that's what we do. But our faith moves us to action, to do whatever God calls us to do. So belief is not enough. You can't just believe in Jesus. James also tells us that the demons believe and they shudder because they know who Jesus Christ is. But belief's not enough. Man, it's got to be followed up with repentance, where we're not only sorry for what we do, but we change the direction of our lives. God, instead of walking away from you, we're going to walk towards you. We're just surrendering to God, to your will. God, I cannot do this on my own. I need Jesus Christ. What do I do? That's repentance. We confess, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And our faith says, God, whatever you tell me to do, I'm going to do it. And so Peter told us to be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. That's what we do. There's no work in baptism. You think about that. There is no work in baptism. You walk into a baptistry, somebody else puts you under the water and brings you back up. God did the work through His Son, Jesus Christ. But we've got to align ourselves, put ourselves in a place where we can receive that mercy and that grace that God gives us because of His great love. So let me just say it this way. This is something for you to remember. Jesus saved us from death. So let's live like we're alive. Okay, we're told here, Paul says, Jesus moves you from death to life. That happens because of God's mercy and grace. It happens because of Jesus' sacrifice on the cross. And if we've been saved from death, we should start living like we're alive. Man, even when crazy things are going on in our lives, when bad times come in, and we know those are going to be a part of our lives, but people should still see us standing on the hope of Jesus Christ. Our faith may get shaken, but it should get stronger, to where we are like, okay, God, I don't know why this is going on. I wouldn't have chosen this for my life, but I trust you. My faith is going to be strong. And so I'm going to live like I'm alive. I'm not going to walk around with my head down all the time. And we get to see this in our church and our ministry here. I am amazed by people in our church who are battling cancer, and yet they'll come to church when they don't feel like it. They'll have a smile on their face, and they'll say, you know what? I'm going to get through this with God. Whatever His plan is for my life, I'm going to get through that. We see it when people go through financial struggles. And I know people that have struggled, I mean, to the point of they didn't even know how they were going to pay their bills. And yet they said, God is faithful. I'm going to trust Him. And God pulled them out of that. And so we're able to see in our own context here, in our church family, people whose faith is strong. They know they've been brought from death to life. They know what the future holds one day, and so they're going to live like they're alive. I say this to you a lot, but I want you to understand it. It does not matter how bad or good it is here for you. It doesn't matter if you've got a perfect life, and if you could have laid it out yourself, you'd have said, that's exactly the way I would have laid out my life. It gets better. If your life is in a horrible place and you're thinking to yourself, man, why would God do this to me? Why would God allow this to happen to me? I promise you, it gets better. And Paul, who we've been reading about in Ephesians chapter 2, he says to us that those things, those struggles, those trials, he calls them light and momentary when you compare what we go through here with heaven. Doesn't seem light when you're going through it, does it? Doesn't seem momentary, not when you've dealt with things for months or even years. But I believe when we get to heaven one day, that all of that will be gone. Because when you stand in God's presence, I don't believe we will remember one bad thing ever. All we'll do is know that great love that God had for us, to where He showed His mercy and His grace. But you've got to accept that gift. But when you accept it, you move from death to life. But understand this, living like you're alive is a conscious effort I believe you have to make every day. Every day you have to get up, you have to look in the mirror, and you have to say, you know what? Not today, Satan. Not today. I'm not going to follow your path. I'm going to follow God's path. I'm not going to let other people bring me down. I'm going to stay strong. But you have to make that decision, because if not, you may be going, all right, I'm going to try to do what God wants to do, but you go to the right. All right, God, I'm going to be strong and sweet, but you go to the left, or you go too high, or you go too low, and you miss that mark. You're trying, but you sin. That's okay. That's why Jesus came. I'm not saying it's okay to sin, but I'm saying God understands it. That's why Jesus came. And then in those days where you just, man, you feel in the pit of your stomach and you're like, I'm going to do what I want. You know what? I don't do that very often. Today is going to be the day. God, I'm sorry. I'm going to go back to an addiction. I'm going to go back to some kind of temperament that I've tried to move past. I'm just going to do what I want to do, God. And Jesus' blood is there for us in those moments as well. But you've got to decide it. That's something you need to tell yourself every day. When you become a Christian, it's not like your sinful desires just disappear. Because wouldn't that be amazing? Like if you get baptized and you never have a bad thought again. You never give in to temptation ever. You don't sin. But that's not the way it is. Because we still have that sinful nature where people were living in this world. And so we have to fight against it. But God gives us the Holy Spirit. He says, I'll help you to be strong. When you mess up, I'll help you realize and remember that Jesus still offers his forgiveness. Jesus saved us from death. So let's live like we're alive. If we're going to do that, we've got to realize that there's bad news. We're all sinners. We deserve to be separated from God in hell for eternity. But the good news is, God gave us his son, Jesus. And if we will accept him, then we can live like we're alive. You bow your heads and pray.